So, David is also a former member of the PHW's board, board of directors. Please welcome David Logan.
Thank you, Ed. Thank you all for coming. I'm kind of amazed that so many of you would give up your lunch hour to come talk about lime mortar. I'm going to do my very best to make it as exciting as I think it is. We are a small company. There's about 10 of us. Our shop's up on 600 North Loudoun Street. We're in a 1930s produce warehouse. And if you ever wanted to come see our shop, the doors are always open. You're very welcome. So the title of my talk is the politically correct title, Lime Mortar and Moisture Migration in Historic Structures.
Okay, got it.
But really, the purpose of me being here and what I wanted to share is I really would like the second title to be the accomplishment of today, is stop doing damage to our Winchester buildings by using the wrong materials. And I don't want that to sound at all critical. I want this to be a conversation and just to share what we have learned and are learning. When I used to be at Universal, we would have to give training courses, and my British boss, this was his advice, and then he stole it from these other people. I'm going to tell you what I'm going to say, I'm going to say it, and then I'm going to tell you what I said, and then I'm going to sit down. And I would like this to be a conversation. Please just chime in if you want to clarify. There's so much to talk about. We could talk 8 hours about lime mortar, but I promise we will not do that today. So, this is what the things I would like to cover. I would like to cover the way I view my, I think of it as my education. I've been doing restoration work since I was 18. I have a picture of the first house I ever worked on. It was built in 1860. I just love that house. And I feel like if I do this till I'm 85, I won't have figured it all out. Because there's just so many complexities of how things are working together in our old buildings. And I think it's valuable. I love what I do because I think there's a value to our built environment. I recently read this book called The Architecture of Happiness. And I really think it matters, the spaces that we're in, like this room. I think it makes a difference. If we were in a cinder block room with white ceilings, it just wouldn't feel as good. And I think humans need that more than we realize. Then I went on a 45-minute walk yesterday around Winchester. And I took about 60 pictures or so. And I just put most of them in this slide that we can go through quickly. The damage to our buildings is pretty high here in our town. And I do not mean, this is what I meant by not critical. I don't want this to be me being critical. I just would like to share, because the industry, the masonry industry, isn't interested. The money is somewhere else. This is low volume, low profit part of it, but it's just so important for our old buildings, and we'll get into that. And then I'm going to share with you lime, you know, where do we get it? You can't go to Home Depot or Lowe's. You can't even go to Frederick Block. But it's easy to get. And then we could do a question and answer at the end. My approach and attitude about the technical things we encounter is I always feel like there's something that I don't know and I don't understand. I rarely speak in absolutes. For all the things that we encounter, I always chase people around and ask questions. Experts in plaster. We just recently worked with a South African plaster a couple weeks ago. And I just grill everybody. And I get different answers from different people. And I never know. I never feel like I've got the answer. So I'm not up here today to tell you that. But I'm going to tell you the best I know. And I feel like the more I learn, the more I realize I don't know. it's clear of almost everything. I'm not sure I can say I'm an expert in anything, but I study it every day. And that's why we're members of all these different groups, and we're always contacting new companies that are doing different things, typically traditional. Here is, I think, the crux of what I'd like to say. In the past, we were using lime mortar, starting in the Greek times. They'd take calcium carbonate rocks and they'd burn them, and they would make their own putty that then they would build with. This is lime mortar here. They'd build with and plaster with. It was almost everything in the building besides the structure. We used that for 6,000 years. And then 100 years ago, someone had the bright idea of changing the process. They burned calcium carbonate at a higher temperature, and they made Portland cement. And it created a completely different material. Harder, less flexible. We've only been using it for 100 years. And we're doing incredible amounts of damage to our buildings that were built with a former technology. We think our technology, I don't, but many think our present day technology is better. And I think with Portland cement, it's absolutely wrong. It is not better. This is a place called Fountains Abbey in Yorkshire, England. It is a 12th century monastery that Henry VIII destroyed over some woman. And I took that picture. It is absolutely stunning. This is a stone building built with lime mortar. All the roofs are gone. It's getting rained on in Yorkshire, a pretty rainy place. And it is pristine. This place could be restored for millions of dollars, but all of the masonry is sitting there in just fine shape because the lime mortar is doing everything it's supposed to do. The way it was built in the 1200s, or maybe it was the 12th century, so the 1100s. It was jaw-dropping, and this has just been sitting here for that long. Little maintenance that's just sitting there. And these are the arches underneath. No protection from the weather. So water's landing on top and doing whatever it's doing, evaporation, dripping through. So I kind of touched on the value, but the thing I think is important about the world we live in, I think it matters, and I think it affects our quality of life greatly. There's a complicated slippery slope here that I'm not going to go into, but we can't afford to build buildings like this from scratch, and people need housing, and I'm not making that statement at all. But if we thought more for the long term, another reason I went to England was it was kind of an architectural education. And after a period of 9 days driving all over the place, from York to Ripon to Hadrian's Wall, I asked my boss, I said, we didn't see one piece of asphalt shingle. I didn't see any wood siding the entire time I was there. And I said, why are we not seeing these things? And he looked at me like I was crazy. He said, because it doesn't last long enough. So all the investment in this roof that was probably made in the 1800s is still benefiting the people living in it now. It's cheaper in the long run if we would change our perspectives of building quality. And Winchester has tons of high-quality buildings. It's a very high-quality construction here, lots of brick, lots of stone. And the value, the beauty of a well-designed old building like this building, you know, is obvious. This is that old house. I used to do black and white photography, and I took hundreds of pictures of this house in every different weather. And this house was built in the 1860s, and it was pretty neglected back then. The first job I ever did in restoration was I rebuilt this corner, and I made lots of mistakes. But working on that house was a pleasure. I just thought it was beautiful in a spooky way. We live in an old, you know, fairly old town, and the old buildings that that are around us now are the ones that succeeded. So these old buildings, one of the things I love about what I do is we learn from the stuff that's still here. Probably there was twice as many buildings that were built in the 18th century that fell down, you know, because there are always economic balances. And a few years ago, I wrote a piece for, it was called Why Old Houses Last Longer Than New Houses, and I printed out a few if you guys are interested, and if any of you want a copy, I can send it to you. But I think the design is the first factor in craftsmanship of how the pieces are put together, and then the quality of materials. Those three things go together, and that is the reason that our buildings are still here, because they succeeded in those three items. A 150 years ago, labor was cheap. Materials were expensive. So labor was cheap, so they were doing all this elaborate, beautiful. This is that same massive roof Victorian house that was in the previous picture. Today, labor is expensive. Materials are relatively cheap. There's my point. Materials are relatively cheap. We should be using lime mortar because the material is not an issue. It's not an economic issue. You're still doing the same work. You're just doing it with the wrong materials in this town. That's the Aldi Country Mill, built with lime mortar in 1810 or 12, I remember. still doing fine. We did a restoration on it and did some more spot pointing, but a lot of the original mortar was just in fine shape. Okay. The purpose of mortar, I would really, if someone called us in and said, we would like you to restore our house, I would rather walk up to a wall that looked like this than one that had been smeared with Portland. Because that's a Portland wall. You're in much better shape if you start here. Please interrupt on this part, because this is the most important part for the walk around Winchester. The bricks here were made they're handmade, and they're made in wood-fired kiln. And the ones that end up on the outside of the building are the ones that were the inside of the brick kiln, nearest the fire. They're the hardest, the most resilient. They're the brick masonry units that were handmade. The ones that were on the outside of the kiln ended up going on the interiors of the walls because they weren't as weatherproof. The mortar is sacrificial. The important part of this wall are the bricks. And these bricks run this way, and these bricks run in. And they're probably tying three, they're called Weiss, three Weiss of bricks in a solid brick foundation wall. I don't know if this is three or four. But that's how they tie the widths of brick together. So the job of the mortar is, first of all, to transfer structure, but the outer part is to be flexible and to support those bricks. The mortar is supposed to be softer than the masonry units. It is supposed to be softer. If it's harder, the bricks will fall to pieces. And the third job of mortar is it keeps most water out. And I say most because you can't keep water out. There's no way. If we pointed this wall as perfectly as we could, we went over and pointed it again, if it had driving rain against it, it's going to raise it. The moisture content is going to go up. There's just no way around it. Then the other very important, so as water gets in, a very important job of the mortar is to be permeable, to let the water back out. Because the bricks aren't very permeable. They're less so. Handmade bricks are more permeable than new bricks. But ignoring that, this lime mortar will breathe, and it is very vapor permeable. You could, you know, if this were a wall, you could take a hose and wet it down really well, and a few days later it'd be dried out again. And you could do that from the inside, too. And another incredible thing about lime mortar is it's self-healing. It's flexible. If that wall were to move a little bit, and I'm not talking about a major crack or structural movement, but I've looked at walls that had a 2-inch curve to them. There was an old school in Lincoln, built in the 18th century. It had a 2-inch curve, original pointing, with a crack in it. You couldn't find any cracks, and it wasn't built with that curve. There's free lime available, so when tiny little microscopic cracks form, and the rain comes, wets the wall, dries it back out, lime moves into the cracks. That's incredible, I think. So if this were pointed with Portland, it's not flexible. It's harder than these bricks. It's not softer. Portland cement's far harder. It's not vapor permeable. The only thing that they share is Portland would keep most water out, but not all. When we walk around Winchester with these pictures, we can talk about these points. This is a 120-year-old house, and it was pointed with Portland, and it's doing everything I just listed. And because it's not letting the moisture out, see how these bricks, the faces are falling off? That's called spalling. The reason that happens is because the Portland cement is not letting the vapor out. In the winter, the freeze-thaw cycle, there's enough water in the faces of those bricks that the freeze-thaw pops the faces of the bricks off. I only see that. I won't say only. I don't really. There's probably an exception. I usually see that in Portland repointed walls. Because this wall was laid originally in lime. Does that make sense? The average moisture content of this wall is higher because of the Portland cement. When I was walking around, I just put this slide in. It's kind of out of place. But this is on Boscawen Street. And you see this kind of brickwork where the bricks are laid really tightly. It's a smaller brick joint. That's a very high skill. That's a higher skill bricklaying. And the Rouse Fire Hall is laid that way. I just wanted to mention that. It's a very highly skilled work. And that wasn't repointed, so it's in fine shape. While we're talking about brick buildings, I thought we'd talk about log cabins just really briefly. The job of the daubing, this is daubing between the logs, the job is exactly the same. And if you re-daub log cabins with Portland cement, this is Portland up here. Once the damage starts to happen, you take the Portland out, you find big, like, it's like tooth decay in the logs because it's trapping moisture behind. And this is another picture of spalling. It was a really bad example of the bricks falling apart. So what we're doing is we're mixing materials, Portland cement with old bricks, old handmade bricks, somewhat permeable. That problem's exacerbated. It's why you don't see in new, when you know the argument can be made, well, Portland cement's used in a new construction, you don't have the same failures because new bricks, I'm not saying they're better, but they're less permeable. They're fired in much hotter kilns. So they're not as permeable as the old bricks. So Portland cement's destroying old bricks. That was just a beautiful colonial brick building. Hasn't been repointed. Okay. I just started walking around, and it was kind of frustrating, actually. this whole building is repointed in Portland. See how you see the wet area here? And right here is wet. when I'd come to these dark areas, you'd go up and touch them. And this was yesterday. And it hasn't rained for more than a week. I did it yesterday midday.
You can find that the rising damp is what you're seeing there. It's moisture coming up from the ground. In some cases, it's not coming down from the heavens. It's
I'm going to argue later that there's no such thing as rising.
What was the statement?
Oh boy.
Can you speak up, please?
He's saying there's no such thing as rising damp, but what I'm saying is there's that brick is hydroscopic. It can actually wick moisture up from the ground as well as from the air. But he's going to prove me wrong. So
I'm glad you brought that up. I was talking to, there's been some studies in Europe about this, and I have a picture that talks about rising damp. I think this moisture, yeah, some of it is coming from the rain, maybe that's still in that wall, maybe up high that has sunk down. But the studies in Europe say that the moisture in walls that you see like this are because of condensation. And it's just my guess. The condensation, I think, is coming from the damp air from the basement or crawl spaces, for the most part. Not always. West-facing walls, they're going to get a lot of water and a rain around here. And this is a south-facing wall. So I think this moisture is due to condensation from the interior, and the interior, of course, wouldn't have been repointed, so it's going to be very open to the basement air. And they don't think rising damp happens more than about 30. The guy that I talked to said 30 to 40 centimeters, so that much. That's at least a theory. I won't say it's the correct answer.
I have a wall to show it.
Okay.
And you've worked under it. You know what I'm talking about. In the tavern.
Yeah.
You had rising damp all the way up to the point where the Portland cement had come off the wall.
I think it's condensation.
But we dug a hole, filled it with gravel, it stopped. We'll talk about it later.
Rising. Maybe I'm wrong.
Rising damp is certainly the...
In 10 years, this talk's going to be way better. Just come back.
Rising damp is certainly how we've been taught to understand this particular problem.
I have a picture of a fort. It's sitting in salt water, and it doesn't have any moisture higher than the water line. And I could have found 10 pictures like that. I don't know.
Well, the theory
is...
This is
a typical example of, God, I don't know.
The theory is if you replace the mortar with something that won't conduct the moisture out, then it simply rises higher in the wall than it otherwise would have.
Yeah.
And then, of course, it goes out through whatever it can, and if the bricks are softer than the mortar, it goes out through the bricks.
Maybe as long as things are pointed with lime, you can build in water.
Right. That's what we're saying.
Yeah. I thought was a cool thing to see and talk about. It's the old train station. I would love to work on this building someday. I guess it's the office for the train. The another negative of Portland cement is it's very sensitive to salt. You know, winter salting of your walks destroys Portland cement. Has no effect on lime mortar.
Oh.
You can mix up lime mortar with salt water and use it as mortar. And that's my guess for this. I'm not really sure what's causing this, but this building has been, you know, repointed in Portland. This was an area where actually the Portland cement is further out from the stone. So the stone's being degraded. So the stone's softer than that Portland. Don't you think?
Yeah.
It was just the same picture. There's that fort. During that conversation, and I don't know, but I found a bunch of pictures for mills. I didn't want to get too sidetracked because I told you we could talk 8 hours about it. But I found a bunch of pictures of lime mortar walls in water, like in sawmills, flour mills, the race walls coming up to the entrances. And the water damage is no higher than, you know, a few inches up above the water. I thought that was fascinating. Now, maybe if we went back and repointed this at Portland, it would make it go up.
I think so.
Yeah. Right?
What climate is that in?
That's in Georgia.
Okay, so they don't have too much of the freeze thaw cycle, which probably destroyed it all.
Yeah. I think most of that damage is from the war. So back to Winchester. This is a wall pointed with Portland. Another thing that's out of context is you can tell this wall used to be lime washed. They used to point their brick walls, and then they would put a protective coating on them. So there's a protective jacket that we no longer put on because we want to leave our brick walls exposed. And lime wash does have some additional protection against wetting.
But it breeds. Yeah. I'd also mention that you're looking at sometimes where they have not only pointed with Portland, but they also are sandblasting. So when you sandblast a wall that is made of handmade bricks, you're removing, unintentionally, but you're removing the viscosity layer of the brick, that you're removing that thicker and harder skin to get the paint off and everything else and get it nice and clean looking. And that makes it even weaker so that when the freeze-thaw cycle kicks in, it's even less to fall off.
Yeah.
When
sandblasting destroys walls. There are quite a few very fine houses in Winchester that were sandblasted. I don't know what the solution is. Putting silicone waterproofing is a really bad idea. It exacerbates this whole problem. It traps the moisture in even more, and the moisture contents go up. And if anyone ever tells you use silicone sealant on your bricks, don't do it. The problem is something else. It's the same problem over and over. This whole wall is pointed with Portland. Old walls were meant to breathe interior and exterior. Moisture comes in. Mount Zion Church, we did some work, consulting work in. It's a triple thick brick wall. It gets wet, the west facing wall. They used to breathe to the exterior and interior. They went in and put latex paint all over the interior. Now all the latex paint is blowing off to the inside. And I think if they'd have put lime wash on the inside, they wouldn't have had this problem.
That one looks like it might be a flow line, and there might not be any flashing and weeps to allow the moisture to get out of the wall, regardless of what the mortar was. It just is locked in.
A lot of the modern construction methods of making weep holes and putting ropes in holes, that's all modern to handle water. Back with lime mortar, it didn't need all that.
Yeah.
It just breathed through the walls. The walls were kind of transpiring.
And there's also something very important in that picture. There's a basement window that's been bricked over. We seal up our basements. We seal up our cellars. And we wonder why they're falling apart.
True. Our houses were built with no insulation. Right?
Our ancestors understood. You let a house breathe, especially the cellar. You don't seal it up.
Yeah, that's true.
David, first with your walk yesterday, taking pictures and stuff, I think the police are looking for you today.
I didn't take any pictures of Oak Crest properties.
What about painting brick?
Yeah.
How does that affect it?
Painting, I am told, I just learned this a couple weeks ago with that South African plasterer, that Sherwin-Williams has a line of paints that are quite permeable, vapor permeable. We haven't figured out what they are yet, though. But I have some pictures later of some other kinds of paint, like lime washes. There's a lot of problems with modern latex paints. And I have some pictures of that.
So painting is not necessarily a bad thing as long as you use the right paint.
If you can use a permeable paint, yes.
What if you have a house that's already painted and it?
That's a tough one.
Getting ready to put something on top of
please.
It.
She said she asked, what if you have a house that's already painted? That's a very tough question. It depends on the budget. You can take that paint off with some gentle soda blasting. You can use some peel away. It depends on what you want to do after. But if the paint is blowing off, it's going to continue to blow off unless you remove it yourself.
With,
and I have some pictures of that.
Okay. With what, like a brush?
Peel away or maybe mechanical with a brush. With soda blasting methods, it's very difficult to get thick paint off of brick because it's so full of crags. This was it's a beautiful brick house on Cameron that I didn't see any issues. So far, so good. That's the thing about this, is sometimes houses, you can do a repointing of Portland and you won't see any problems. I'm not sure why.
Usually they point to the foundations as the reason. In other words, if you put put latex paint on the outside, and you reduce the amount of moisture which can get in.
But I've seen spalling.
I've seen spalling
on the second floor levels.
Yeah.
So it's every building's different, I think, mm-hmm. and possibly these bricks are very permeable. Just making that up. I mean, there's a reason, because that is the west-facing face of that building. This is Doral's fire hall. Very fine construction. It's lime mortar. I didn't find any issues at all. It's just beautiful. Beautiful work. Straight as an arrow. Nice tight joints.
David, in that picture you had just before that, what's the discoloration on the base right there?
Right there.
All that discoloration.
I think it might
be
salt.
It's what?
Salt, I think.
Oh, salt.
I'm not really sure. Salt, dirt, you know, right at the sidewalk line. And you see the same. We looked at brick. Stone does the same thing. These wet marks, I actually went up and touched them, and they're really cool along that dark band. And I didn't see much above this height, you know, on the walk yesterday. So maybe Byron's right. No. This was a house that I watched the mason was very good. He did very nice V joints. And I called the owner when they had the material stocked. I said, please don't use that material. It's the wrong material. And he said, and here's the issue, because I respect masons. They work very hard. It's a tough job. He said, my mason's been doing this for 30 years, and he's comfortable with this material. He doesn't want to use something else. So they repointed this whole building just a couple years ago, and now it's for sale. With Portland cement. And he did a very nice job. And for about $300 additional dollars, he could have done the whole thing in lime. And see the wet spot right there by the stairs? And this side, this is the west side. It's really bad. And this building didn't used to show wet spots. And the sidewalk's not helping at all, I'm sure.
Yes.
But the water's getting in, and a week later, it's staying wet. And if we were in a freeze-thaw cycle, someone is going to pay for this, and it's not going to last 100 years like the last repointing did. This was a wall. I wanted to be fair. This was a wall that looks fine. And I think it's north-facing, if I remember right. See how every, that course, and then every I'm not sure what the count is, but they sometimes vary. And that's the header course that's going in and tying to the second width of bricks. We worked on a mill in Leesburg, and it had a header course, two running courses, or three running courses, and then another header course, then three. So we've seen different styles, and it is a really interesting look, I think.
The fact that this has a limestone foundation above the brick, I think, is significant. It's in all likelihood that the limestone foundation, first of all, limestone is not going to show the freeze-thaw problem as quickly as brick will. It's a much more durable, much stronger material for obvious reasons, but it also, I'm sure that wall has, well, I don't know.
That foundation was reported with Portland.
Okay.
This whole thing's Portland cement.
Right. But it's still, we're looking at limestone as opposed to brick.
Yeah.
Which is significant, I think. It's not as hydroscopic as bricks are.
Yeah, but there's other limestone pictures in here that show the same thing. This is a very, very old painting. You can see the white. And then someone went back with Portland cement and just smeared the repair. I don't. That wasn't a great grassman. You know, where most of the work we're looking at is, like that last stone house.
Is the white Portland?
No, the white's lime. White's original. There's no reason why they couldn't have matched it. And if you're interested, my supplier talks about how hard it is to import this white powder into New York. But this is French. It's from a quarry called Saint-Astier that the Romans opened. Then I think it went dark for 1,000 years or something, and it's open again. This is Saint-Astier lime. And I don't know if you're interested.
Can't you get hydrogenated lime? Is that good?
You can't. It's burned at too high a temperature. Old lime was manufactured over wood fire, about 1,000 degrees.
Max. The place in Virginia did that.
Yeah, they've outsourced all of it, and their lime quality has gone way down. The very best stuff is at least available. You can get good available quantities are from there.
What's it cost? 5 pounds?
A bag costs about $35.
For 10 pounds?
No, it's a 50-pound bag.
David, that's the product that you're going to mix lime mortar out, not lime putty?
No.
Why is that?
Lime putty. I told you we could talk 8 hours there.
Yeah, so the only experience I've ever had is with lime putty.
So lime mortar is made by taking calcium carbonate rocks of a certain quality, and I don't understand all the ins and outs of it, and they burn it at a controlled temperature, a low temperature, and that becomes a reactive, very light rock, and then they put it in water, and it turns back into lime putty. Lime putty historically was used by plasterers. In the 70s, they were using lime putty on laying, but that's not what masons used. And I have some pictures. They were using the calcium oxide ground up, mixing it with sand, and they did what was called a hot mix. They would mix water with the sand with the quick lime, and it would get hot because the reaction happened right then. But that's what they were using to lay. This is quick lime that has then been re-dried and put in bags. So it's reacted already.
This is what this is.
That's been reacted, and then, so it's not dangerous. If you mix it with water, it wouldn't have that.
So no one's using the correct lime, so this is very hard to get.
Not hard to get. But you're right, no one's using the correct lime in Winchester.
David, I can't remember if this is the case or not, but Department of Interior's preservation briefs, they talked about the mortar. Did it say something in there about using Portland cement or cutting wood lime?
Yeah, I think they've changed that.
They've changed that?
I think so. It's been discussed for the last 5 years that it's wrong. People in the Park Service aren't using it. They had a recipe of, I don't remember now. one part Portland, one part lime, five parts sand, something like that. As soon as you put Portland into a lime mix, it loses its plasticity, permeability, self-healing. All of those qualities go away. And all the people in the National Park Service I've talked to say, yeah, we know, we don't use that recipe, but it's been online for 5 years.
What about the local lime companies lowering the heat?
Yeah, I think Virginia Lime Works was talking to some people about doing that. But their lime is not from as pure a source as the calcium carbonate from San Astier. And it gets these really spooky, scary, like, green colors as it's setting. And for us, it's like, our reputation's on the line here. And it turns this weird color, and then it goes white. And it's got some impurities in it. I think it's probably something about the burning process.
What's quality rocks? I mean, I look at these lime rocks all the time. You get the gray ones, you get the light gray or the dark gray?
Blue?
It depends on the region, because you're getting into an area that I can't speak. I can't speak in detail about it, but because of different elements in it, like magnesium, or I'm not sure what, chromium, some of the lime will set underwater. Some of it's hydraulic. Some of it's air. And in different places, you can get mixtures from the same quarry. So the quality control is very difficult. 150 years ago, the guys that went down to the lime kiln road and got their lime knew what that lime, how it was going to act. They got to know their local lime. Those kilns are now closed, whatever they were using. I think there's one down in Stevens City, but they're no longer quarrying it. So, for my caution, I want to use lime that I know how it's going to act. And the quarries that I wish I could get to are no longer operating. Does that make sense? Some limes can be set underwater. And others you can mix up and leave in a bucket as long as you put the top on and you don't let CO2 get to it. They'll stay. They'll stay good. Others will set in the bucket. Yeah, this wall. In the historic standards, you don't want to go into a place and tear out all the original mortar. You want to leave as much original as possible. And so much of this wall is fine. It just needs some spot pointing. You could have gone over the whole thing, saved the job a ton of money, left what was good, and just replaced. I assume there was a crack there or something. But there's some pointing here that needs to be filled in and done.
In the preservation briefs, I think they say for repointing that you're supposed to break out the joints like 2 inches deep. So you're saying that's not a good thing to do?
The way I was taught is that the joint should be cleaned out twice as deep as it is wide. So if it's a very thin joint, 1/4 inch, you only have to go in about a half. And if it's got a void there and a cavity, as long as you're not pointing over dust. Oh, that's another important thing. Lime mortar is persnickety in one area. And Joel and I have worked together on trying to figure this out a little bit better. But you have to keep it wet. You've got to keep it wet for 7 to 10 days. So before you point this wall, you've got to hose it down. We think you have to hose it down for all day because that wall will take a lot of water. You can't just go up to a drywall and put lime mortar in it because it will turn back to dust and fall out. We have had failures, learning the hard way. It's great education, I guess.
So when you go up to an existing wall, like the very first picture you had that showed the mortar was worn away,
yeah.
The first thing everybody does is they take a pocket knife or a screwdriver and start poking at the mortar. How hard should that lime mortar be? Should you be able to, with a screwdriver, scrape it out?
Absolutely. I was scraping out some yesterday on my walk with my fingers. I actually took a video, but it won't play on PowerPoint. But I have a picture of that. You can walk up to this wall a mess. But it's soft.
Yeah.
If you look at these walls, you can see the lime chunks. Those are called lime inclusions. It's a result of the hot mix. If you were mixing up this with lime putty, you wouldn't have that. It would be consistent. Plasterers. They were using the best, because you used to pour this quicklime in a pit on the job, and then they would fill it with water, and then they would cover it up and leave for 2 years. And that lime in that pit would settle out. The hard stuff, the coarser stuff would go to the bottom, the fine stuff would go to the top. The top was what the plasterers would skim off and use. This was, at the very least, I thought, if you're going to use the wrong material, you should at least match the color. The reason lime, you know, often lime mortar, you walk up to it and it's got this nice cream color. The reason it's that color is because of the sand. And probably if we walked along the town run, we came, found a sandbar, that probably mixed with that lime in that bag would match this color, because they didn't go far for their sand. It was just too much work. And so that's really how you can get a very good color match, is just try to experiment with local sand if you can. And if you can't, there's an even easier way, which I'll share with you. We get our lime from a place called Pennsylvania Lime Works. And I have contact information for you. The guy, I really trust him. He's a mason. He loves this stuff. He's one of the guys I've chased around asking lots of questions. And he just loves it. And he's not selling it because he's a salesman. He's just selling it because he believes in it. And he's just gotten my trust. And they sell or distribute the San SDA lime. And they have pre-mixed bags with sand in it that he can make for you with color matching. It's very easy. He's got a little kit with a bunch of different colors in it. And you can use that kit to get your color close, or he'll custom mix the different colors. So you can buy it pre-mixed for the color, because we can't afford to go down to the local stream and dig our own sand out. This was a wall that was on Loud Street, and it reminded me of the one in Fredericksburg, where it could be brought back to life very quickly. You'd clean it out with a brush, then you'd wet it down, then go home, come back the next morning, probably wet it down again, and then start pointing, as long as it's not soaked. And this, I think, I'm not sure if it's paint. If it's paint, it's at the end of, being blown off. But most old walls, you see remnants of lime mortar. And that is Richard Bell's cabin on South Loudon. And most of that's Portland cement still. But, it's so far so good. It's probably hiding. Portland cement tends to hide problems. Don't you think?
Yeah, when you're talking about chinking between logs, it's, as you described it, it's tooth decay when you take it out. Anytime you are going to make it so that there's moisture is trapped in a place where there's wood.
Yeah. And Byron always tells me, wood is food.
That's true.
We're building our houses with food. But this, we got to repair this one, and this one, the lighter colored ones, because we had to do some log repairs.
Good.
There was rot going on. So these now are all lime mortar. It's that same. We used cream colored sand and white mortar. And I thought a great parallel, and this is a cabin we're doing in Loudoun County. It's an 18th century cabin. It was listing badly, and the owners asked us to straighten it up and tidy it up. It's been a lot of fun. I thought a great parallel was the way they're building in, built in England. I think that's the date of this building. Or at least it's close, if it's the address. But this lime mortar up here is doing exactly what it would do in a log cabin. And look how everything's in fine shape. If you Portland cemented this wall, that woodwork would fall apart in 25 years. But because it's being allowed, it's allowed to dry. And this is in York, England, so they get lots of rain. I thought that was an interesting parallel with log cabins. Same function of the material. And also, Portland cement would never withstand the movement of a wood building like that. This, on the walk, I came out on this wall, and it is latex or oil paint. And it's doing what all latex and oil paint does on old masonry. It looks like it's been doing this for a while, because it's just blowing off. So, historically, walls were whitewashed. And whitewash was just lime and water. And you could put pigments in them to make them a color. Like I said, this whole education is having to be relearned in the 20th century, you know, starting in the 20th century. Because we lost this technology, we thought that we knew better, and we left it. So masons starting in the 60s and 70s and 80s, and Scottish Lime Center in Scotland has been a huge leader in this. It's trying to figure out what we've lost, because like everything, the more you do something, the more you realize there are tricks and nuances to it. And so all the people that knew this material were then dead. We've had to kind of relearn it. Hopefully some of the traditions remained around the world. I don't know how all the knowledge has come back, but we're still on a learning curve, though, I think. At least I certainly am. But we've started using a lime-based paint called potassium silicate. One of the manufacturers' name is Kime. You've probably heard of Kime. And Pennsylvania Lime Works has their own version of silicate paints. Chemically, they bond to the silica in the wall, so they have a quite tenacious bond, and they're very breathable. And we did this on a building in South London that Larry Belkin designed. So I'm excited. This is the first job we've used silicate paints, but a lot of other people, I don't really jump into much. I don't use anything really unless the technology is older than 200 years. And even with that, I tread very cautiously. So I ask a lot of people lots of questions. And we got this material from Pennsylvania Lime Works after harassing the owner a number of phone calls. But you can get it in all colors, and I'll be very interested to see how that holds up. That's the same. This building had never been Portland cement pointed, so we just did spot pointing. We had to do a lot of mechanical scraping on this. We actually had to use peel away on the front. It was so thick. The front had been painted many more times than the sides and back. So we used a chemical called peel away. It's a strong base that it's a nasty process, but it turned the paint to goo. And we basically just scrubbed it off. And then you power wash the goo off the bricks, gently power wash.
Is there different peel away for bricks than for wood?
Yeah.
So you don't have to put the paper layer on?
I think you do have to use the paper. They may recommend peel away one, but I call the company often and say, which one do you recommend? And they often recommend peel away one. That's the one we typically use. But they have many different grades. This is the old jail, and it hasn't been highly affected by repointing. There's some really unmatched pointing in the end, but that building's still breathing. And it's in very fine shape. When was that built?
Late
1800s. And I was just walking up the walking mall, and it's kind of more of the same. This building was very wet over there behind that little cart. And it looked to me like the bricks are really starting to deteriorate low down. It's especially the winter we just had, so much hard freeze thaw.
What's the easiest way to tell the difference between the line mortar and the Portland mortar? Is it just the line is easy to flake off?
This was the... I'm sorry, that didn't work, but I took a video, and this is on the Sullenberger building. I walked up to it. See this, these line inclusions? That's the hot line, so I'm mixing it dry. I walked up to that mortar joint, and I just did this. See how different that looks from that? I just did it with my hand. I could have gone in an eighth of an inch if I kept doing it. If you walk up to lime, if you walk up to mortar and it has lime inclusions and it's kind of soft and you can affect it with your fingertips, it's lime mortar, chances are.
You can feel the difference between that and Portland.
If you go up to Portland, it's like these tiles. I mean, it's rock hard.
It's hard as mortar.
Yeah. Rock hard, and you won't scrape any aggregate out of it. I don't know what to say about these next few slides. Sullenberger Building is a beautiful building, and all of the rework was done with Portland cement. That not only was the wrong material, but it doesn't match at all.
And they parged it.
David, do you know when new construction, new masonry construction in Winchester became almost universally Portland cement? In other words, when did the build, if the building's from 1890s or 1910s or 1920s, is there some cutoff point where you can say, oh, if this building was built after this date, they were using Portland cement?
I don't know the exact date, and the reason I say that is Portland cement started to be used in the big cities kind of late 1800s. Isn't that the date you think of in D.C. and New York? And a lot of the builders, like our company, didn't embrace it. They kept building with what they knew well into the 20th century. So I think we've looked at buildings built in the 1920s that were still lime mortar. So I don't know the answer.
When did they abandon the beehive kilns so that they had, the gas fired?
Yeah.
I mean, because that when the brick became different, it fit together. You know, in modern construction, I don't think you'd want to build a new brick building with lime mortar, not today, with the bricks that are available, would you?
I think it would be fine to do that. No. The other way around is the real problem. If you use Portland cement with old bricks. But I don't know when the kilns, I don't know when lime kiln were,
There's articles you could read on the subject of the history of brick technology, but it is very rapid succession of the 20th century that you start to see these changes.
Yeah. This building, I just don't understand it. Unless that's an architectural statement.
Amazing.
The right material was available, and the masons had to do the same exact thing. And, I'm not sure what to say.
Where is that?
That's the Sullenberger Building.
Oh.
Just done, a couple years ago. And, they use new bricks and...
Seal up the basement.
I said I wouldn't be critical, but that's a whole lot of not caring.
Yeah. Or not knowing how to care in some cases.
It's pretty in a strange way. But the other thing I wanted to mention was Tim Machado, a local architect, taught me this. The method of putting these capstones on used to be set in lime mortar, and when they started putting them in Portland, these things would break. But now, all up down our walking mall, we have these things set in caulking, and then the joints between have to be caulked. I thought that was interesting. I just learned that from him. This is where we get it, and I just really think a lot of these guys, they help us technically. They put up with all my questions. They're nice people, and they're the kind of people that say, They'll tell you when you don't need something, if you guys are interested in that.
And they'll tell you their formulas.
They'll give you lots of technical. Yeah, that's the thing I like about it, is there's nothing secret. They're not putting voodoo in these bags. They're putting lime and sand and pigment, and they'll tell you what's in there. That's the thing I don't like about Virginia Limeworks, is they wouldn't tell you what they're doing.
Proprietary.
Yeah. And it shouldn't be proprietary, because it's lime and sand.
Is there a difference between the interior bricks and the mortaring? Because most of your pictures have been on the outside from your wall, obviously, but on your inside, if you're talking about pouring water on it, you know, and things of that nature, you use the same technique and the same process?
No difference. Historically, the inside was still a breathable coating. The only difference would be that you could use what was called salmon bricks, the outer bricks from the kiln, because they weren't as resistant to moisture. You could use them on the interior. Mortar was the same. Huh. They'd build these walls all at the same time.
Right. What was that you called it? What did you call it?
Salmon bricks. Salmon?
Yeah.
It's just the lighter colored bricks that don't get fired as hard. Ed's told me to pick up the pace, and that's it. If you're interested, I'm a newbie at this. Not a Luddite, but a newbie. We're putting pictures on our Facebook page of jobs, and I'm hoping to put lots of historical work.
And it will be lime mortar for the Winchester Little Theater restoration be coming from Pennsylvania?
Yes. Yeah. Virginia Limeworks used to share the distribution of San SDA lime. I'm not sure. Maryland South and Pennsylvania Limeworks did Maryland North. Virginia Limeworks decided they wanted to go proprietary, so they dropped it. And Pennsylvania Limeworks picked up the whole country. He didn't go for that. He didn't even ask for it. But it sure must be a wonderful thing for him, I would think. It's still a very small market, though.
I found this very interesting. I had been on an expedition a while back in Mexico, and it was for, we were mapping conquest period architecture, basically the Mayan pyramids and the Mayan ceremonial centers, because it's not just pyramids, there are all kinds of structures or homes, etc. And they were incredibly, these are structures that were not excavated, fully excavated, so they have growth on them, etc. And I was always fascinated, like, how these sustain thousands of years in this kind of environment, because it's out in the open. And it turns out that they're built out of limestone, and they had, I guess, your version of a lime mortar between them. You know, so that I just found that incredibly fascinating. There are also no above-ground water systems. They said the entire Yucatan peninsula is a limestone shelf.
Really?
Yeah. Very dry, very humid, and no above-ground water systems. But those pyramids are everywhere. And I mean, we were not in the tourist areas. We were in the villages and in the rural areas where there were a lot of them, completely covered by earth, partially under earth, et cetera. And they were very, very much intact.
I would love to see that.
Yeah.
So that's very much like that place in England, completely unprotected.
Right. And I thought of that right away, and I was trying to map, like, what's this time period? And it was about 2000 BC.
2000 BC.
When a lot of these were built.
And we know better.
So I guess one question is, how do we fix it? Let's say if our wall has been repointed with Portland cement, how do we go back and stop it from failing?
It is an expensive, unfortunately, it's an expensive proposition for the owner the next time that they have Portland. Because that Portland cement is very difficult to get out. It really has to be taken out by hand. Very carefully, you can run a grinder down the middle of the joint, which gives it a place for the mortar to break away by hand. But you can tear up a wall with a grinder because you have the bricks if you're not careful. Just the important thing is that the next time it's pointed, it has to be pointed with the right material. And I've been quoted numbers like $20 a square foot for some of those walls that look really intact to get that stuff out and then repoint. The buildings are way better off if they were never maintained. Preservation by neglect is a way better situation than this.
How would you grade the work in this basement?
It looks very lime mortary right here. It doesn't look like they tried to change the interior. Right, John? Left it alone.
Right. I wasn't talking about the overall interior. I simply talked about the walls. So.
Yeah. The walls, they don't look like they were repointed at all. Which is a good situation.
The mortar between the bricks of my office building, which I believe is late 1790s, is crumbling terribly. You just dig it out. It's been painted many times, but the mortar's never been changed.
Well, that's good.
But can you add lime mortar to a crumbly surface?
Not a crumbly surface. That's another wonderful thing about lime mortar is it will bond to itself 150 years apart. So as long as you get out the loose, you can't point over dust or there won't be any. Get out the loose and wet it. The wetting part is very important. Then the old lime will bond with the new. It's a compatible material, idea. When you go back into an old building, use compatible materials. So you're in very good shape there. And a lot of masons are resistant to this, and I really hope this group can help gently introduce these ideas, because a skilled mason, like the one that did that stone building, can easily do this with just a few little tricks and tips. But they're not selling it at Frederick Block. And I'll say, nor do I think they care. So I would be very happy if any of you called and said, can you help us get this? Because we order from Pennsylvania Lime all the time. And we could combine an order. Or maybe we have a material at our warehouse that you can use. Because you need a surprisingly small amount of in some jobs. It's just a few bags. Said today labor is expensive, materials are relatively cheap.
Yeah.
I have never bought a bag of Portland, or it has been for a long time, but I think they run about $12 a bag, 50 pounds, $15 a bag or so, and a bag of lime is about $35. So it's double. But you only need, like on that brick house, that stone house, he probably only used, I don't know, $400 worth of Portland. And he would have used $800 worth of lime. So it's a $400 differential. And he probably spent $15,000 on the labor.
$15,000.
Those are my round numbers. Relatively, it's very, very small. And I think costs, they're an important factor. But the cost difference isn't enough to factor.
Thanks a lot, David.
Thank you, David.
As Ed said, a lot of buildings in Winchester have been demolished, but we also have a lot of buildings, that are still remaining. Really, where you start to see the demolitions come into play in Winchester is about 1920. That's where you start seeing the demolitions, not just to replace like a single house for a single house, but you start seeing either like subdivisions parking lots or taking down an old house to put in brand new construction. So I've kind of organized this in three sections. One large house demolished for subdivisions, a house demolished for modern construction, and then obviously the worst is a house demolished for a parking lot. So let's get started. This is view of Winchester about 1900. Do you guys recognize where this is in Winchester? Yep, this is where the Handy Mart is. And that building's obviously gone. The building opposite it is a parking lot now. That house actually was not intentionally demolished. It blew up in a gas explosion. And then up here in this corner, that house, does anybody recognize that house? That tower? Yes, that is Angerona, the poorhouse of Winchester, and later female academies. This picture was taken, as you can see, from the Winchester Inn. And that building looked like this. So this building was originally, if you can believe it, this was also a replacement of an older building that was here. This was originally Aspen Hill. This is where Bushrod Taylor of the Taylor Hotel used to live. And in about 1890, 1891, Judge Hanley was convinced that a basically a resort hotel in Winchester would be more advantageous to Winchester's economy than his idea to have a park. Unfortunately, his idea to have a hotel really was not the prosperous economic idea that he thought it was going to be. And the hotel remained empty until 1900. It was empty for 10 years. They got someone to take over the hotel, and the lessee abandoned it in just a couple months. And after that, it was used for a school for a little while. But this building, as you can see, was then demolished in 1919. And that's what's here now. As you can see, this is basically the subdivision on Lee Street and up farther on the hill where the hospital is. And there were actually houses where this parking lot was as well.
Old hospital.
Old hospital, yep. All right. 307 South Washington Street. If you were one of the few people who were able to go to the Holiday House tour last year, you might have heard about Judge Parker. He owned a good deal of land on Washington Street. And if you know where, how Thornhill sits on its lot, the next block up, Judge Parker's house was also kind of in the middle of that entire block. So after he passed away, his house was demolished to put in several more houses in that block. And what was interesting about this house is that it was reportedly designed by Thomas Jefferson. And you might be wondering, well, okay, who's Judge Parker? He was the judge at John Brown's trial. And as you can see, today, approximately in the middle of two houses. And this one, this is the one we saw the tower on, the first slide. So this is Angerona. This was the poorhouse originally. And it operated as several different female academies in Winchester from about 1830s to the early 1900s. You can see, let me see if I can point. Yes, you can see out front we have some of the ladies of the school standing out here in this picture. This one was a little bit of a different situation. Angerona actually was in a fire sometime in the late 1920s and then was later demolished, probably in the early 1930s. Here's what we have today. So basically all these houses up here on this little extension of Piccadilly went in after Angirona was taken down. So that's still actually the Angirona Neighborhood Watch. You can kind of find that name still. Now on this next one, this is where we start getting into some of the more egregious demolitions. So this was known as the Cannonball House on South Loudon Street. It was owned by the Connor family. They bought it in 1851. And they were in residence during the Civil War. And on the night of August 18th, 1862, a cannonball passed completely through the house. And just by luck, the family was tending to the sick children in the upper stories of the house, and the cannonball would have gone through the parents' bedroom, but because they were with the children, everyone was safe. And after that cannonball passed through the house, you can see they stuck the cannonball back in the house and then put up a sign to commemorate what happened. And here is what they put in about 1959. They put the cannonball back in the building. I mean, they were very proud of that.
It's not the way it looks now.
Yes, this, I think, was taken in the 1970s, this photo. So this one is the Griken Glove Factory and the Hart Hotel. This is on North Cameron Street. You might have seen this in some of the Out of the Past articles that run in the Star. This one gets a lot of play, I think, with visitors. It'll say, like, so-and-so was staying at the hotel. And as you can see, this one, you'll probably recognize this. The modern apartments. Yes, the modern apartments on North Cameron Street, a little up from Reeder and Schwartz's office. And of course, now we would look at that beautiful factory building and think we could repurpose that for apartments now. But yes, this was the Empire Theater. This is how it originally looked when it was built. It had lots of Art Nouveau decorative motifs on the exterior. You may not be able to see it, but you know, the lettering on the theater was, you know, very much that Art Nouveau style. Originally, evidently this was a little too fancy for Winchester, and they took off all that decorative motifs by the 1930s. And then they demolished it in the 1960s for the bank, BB&T Bank drive-through.
Sandra?
Mm-hmm.
That decorative stuff, was that like the things that are now on the Coast Building?
It looks like it was stained glass of some sort.
That had come from another building.
Oh. Hmm. That is interesting. I do not know. Something to check on. Now, this store is on South Loudon Street. It has kind of an interesting history to it. It was originally owned by two sisters. Evidently, the last remaining sister was named Elizabeth Pritchard. And when she died, she left this house to Charles Henry and his wife, you know, as a thank you for taking care of her in her old age. And from about 1875 or so, the Henrys operated this building as a fruit and veggie stand. You can see right over here is where they, you know, had their bins for their fruit and veggies. And evidently the Henrys became quite prosperous doing this. And when Henry passed away in 1948, he attempted to leave his estate to the John Kerr School. And his heirs fought this and actually had his will deemed invalid so that they could keep their inheritance. And sometime after it left Henry's control, they put in the insurance building. It says 52, so probably about the time they got the will settled and down with the house. Yeah, you guys recognize this one. This one makes the rounds on Facebook quite a lot. This is the Barton home. It was also on South Washington Street. So, you know, Lewis Barton, historian of Winchester, this was his family home. It's also one of the few Second Empire style buildings that was in Winchester. So this is like the Gavis house. This one's more of the square form than his version with the wings. And it was demolished for the church. So I don't have the church in here also, but there was the Braddock Street Church used to face on Braddock Street. And as you can see, in the 1960s, they tore down the old church, rebuilt here, which also took out the Barton House. And I think it was just those two buildings that the church took down. But that was quite a loss on that corner. Of course, that's probably a contributing structure now. Like this one. This after picture is almost more interesting for all the changes to the downtown instead of the building. The building we're talking about is right here. This was apparently the second Masonic lodge in Winchester. This was in use during the time of the Civil War. So if you might have seen in some of the histories about McKinley becoming a Mason in Winchester, this is the building that was in use. So this is where he was made a Mason. And as you can see, it's already starting to be demolished in this picture. And in the after, it was a bank. I think it was in drive-through originally, and now I think it's an ATM. Here's another one with a Civil War connection. This is the Kent Street Presbyterian Church. You guys recognize where this is? Yep, where the star is. This building was built about 1838 to 1839. The Presbyterian Church had had a falling out. The congregation split. Half left the church and started their own on Kent Street. And they were here until about 1900. When it was converted to a steam laundry, and then there was a garage in here. And then in 1937, it was torn down. And star building. That one's not, it's more sad for the loss of the history in that building, because again, if you've done your Civil War research, this is that was a church where Stonewall Jackson worshipped during his time in Winchester. All right, guys recognize this one. This is called the Piccadilly Apartments. You can kind of see. I think on that handout map we have, there's Mrs. Hopkins lived here in the 1870s, if you find it. And then right before it was torn down, it was Mrs. Frank Buckley, who apparently owned it. I don't have any other information on that, but here's another building that could have easily been adapted for what went in next. Ooh. That one, yeah, Social Security building. It's right across from the Colonial Arts and Crafts building. So that I think was more of a loss for that street, just to have that block of a building right across the front. Okay, Betty Dandridge. Who remembers, who knows what that name means? Yes. She was his daughter. Evidently, her mother was a semi-invalid, and during the time that Zachary Taylor was in the White House, she was the hostess for the White House. And I have a little quote of, you know, basically what a wonderful hostess she was. She became widely acquainted with noted men and women during her brief but brilliant regime in the White House, and she was known far and wide as a young woman of rare fascination and beautiful character. It was regarded as a high honor to be asked to one of her entertainments. So, of course, we can't keep that house. This is where Winchester Printers was. I have one note that said it may have been a parking lot initially, but the Winchester Printers building must have gone in very soon after the house was demolished. Now this one, I don't think you will have seen this photo before. This was one that PHW used back in about 1963 when we were getting started as an example of this was a bad idea to tear this house down. This was the Hollis House. It was on the corner of Cork and Kent Street, so where the Sheets is now. This house was built about 1830, and Charles Hollis was a tanner, and he possibly operated at least one, maybe both, of the tan yards that were on that corner of Kent Street. And I had to use the old photo. So that was actually what that looked like before the Sheets got in there. And that was, I believe it was an Atlantic.
Poe's Belly Barn.
Poe's Belly Barn, yeah.
Which is much more.
And this is, right, who was here for Tim's lecture last time and remembered that, yeah. I think I was recording, so I didn't see, but I think most people said what went in this lot was non-contributing. That this is probably why you thought it was non-contributing, because of the Chanticleer Inn. This was built about the 1850s, but usually it's referred to, if it's not the Chanticleer Inn, it's the Denny House. So who was Denny? He was the man who had it after the original owner. And according to Russell, he improved it. So that kind of code for improving means adding, it's a little hard to see, but you see these are flat top windows with some molding over the top. So most likely when he improved it, he added those kind of decorative motifs to the building. Denny, unfortunately, I'd hope there was going to be a good quote, but he was a character in Mark Twain's book, Innocents Abroad. Denny was apparently part of this expedition that Mark Twain took. And he's mentioned, I think it's chapter 32, he finds some grapes. Unfortunately, that was all he did. And I was surprised. That book, which I had never heard of before I started researching this, was Mark Twain's bestseller during his lifetime, and it was the best-selling travel book of its era. Now, here's where we really... Oh, let me show you what was there afterwards. So this is the bank building that in Tim's lecture last month. That is a contributing building now, but I'm sure everyone who said that's not contributing is because you were thinking of the Chanticleer and what was lost. I was very happy to find this little photo. Obviously, it was from a newspaper, but this is another one that PHW used back about 1963 when we were getting started. This was, just a little vernacular stone house, but it was used by Dr. Baldwin. You may, if you're familiar with Mary Baldwin College, he was, I believe, her father or her grandfather. That was that connection. But Dr. Baldwin was also the physician to Lord Fairfax. And a couple stories claim that Lord Fairfax may have died in this building, and somehow Dr. Baldwin came to be in possession of his boots, and the boots were apparently in this building for quite a while. Kind of a strange story. But this building, I had to use an old photo for this one too, because this is shocking. Here's your first parking lot. This was for the Kern Motor Company. Originally, this was part of, I guess, their sale lot for their cars. And now there are modern apartments in here. They're townhouses, yeah. So this is another building I was happy to find in that newspaper article from 1963. This is the Lore Capper House. So this is on North Loudoun Street, and this was one of several houses in that block. They were all demolished for, I'll just show you. Originally, this was the Sears parking lot. The parking garage is on this spot now. So all of the houses that were in this block, you know, they were probably 1830s or earlier. One of the houses in that block was Rebecca Wright's house. You may know her name from the Civil War. She was a Quaker, who I believe, was it Sheridan, that she was slipping notes to? Yeah. So her house was in that block. There's also a Rodman house and a Lillian Sheets house. Now this one is kind of interesting. This is right down the street from us, probably as you pass the Star Building over here. You pass by that block. These were probably post-1870, so these are some of the newer houses. But on the Sanborn maps, they're listed as the Faulkner Block. And from what I can find out, the Faulkners apparently were merchants for ladies' shoes. And apparently they, you know, clustered in this one area. And it's unusual to see in the Sanborn map that just a residential block would have a name like that. It's very unusual. So I'm wondering the story on that. Obviously, we're in the parking lot section now, so here we are. Some of you are probably parked right there. And this one. This is kind of a twofer. We're mainly looking at the church, which was St. Stephen's Church. This was a black church. But also we have a little laundry building, kind of the corner of it right here. So the church, they were here sometime prior to 1870. They do appear on that map handout. But in 1928, they purchased their own land and moved out. And this building was actually demolished prior to the 1947 Sanborn. So it was gone a little earlier than that 1950s date. The laundry managed to stay a little longer, but you'll probably recognize this lot. This is the First Presbyterian's church lot now. This one, if you've seen some previous iterations of this slideshow, you may have seen this listed as the W.B. Snyder House. I did a little more research and found out the original owner was William Baker. Snyder evidently was a later occupant. You probably remember it better as the American Legion building. It actually has its sign out in this photo right there. And this was, I think, one of the first ones on North Cameron Street that was taken down for parking lots. And guess what? It's still a parking lot. I don't have a lot of information on this one, but as you can see, this is on North Braddock Street. So orient yourself. Basically, where I'm standing is the corner of Braddock and Boscawen Street. Over here, right here, we have the little corner of a filling station, and then boop, boop, two houses. The one we're actually looking at is the stone house. This was owned by the Pfeiffer family, and it was, you know what's coming, parking lot. Now this poor little house, I think PHW may have had a hand in accidentally demolishing this house sooner than it would normally have been demolished. We had marked this on our 1966 list of buildings and said that this one was worthy of preservation. And apparently, right after we said, this house, we should save this house, it was demolished. And it's still just a grassy lot. And this one, you probably recognize what's in the background there. That's the George Washington Hotel, just a little bit farther down the road from us. And this was the home of Mary Greenhow Lee. She was a Civil War diarist. So basically, this was the house she was living in as she was recording her diary. And, you know, we have to have more parking spaces. I mean, what is that, like 12 spaces? Gotta have it.
Now, the old police station, though.
Yes.
Where was that in?
The next parking lot up, I guess.
That driveway went down the north side of the police station. Gotcha.
What is Boxwoods in that previous photo? I feel like some old Boxwoods.
I don't see any. I know Stuart Bell had written that there were Boxwoods over here. I don't see them in this picture, but I think it may just be a stone wall. And you knew I had to end with this one. So this is the Conrad House, and this was the straw that broke the camel's back for preservation in Winchester. After losing all of those previous buildings, this was the one that had the most history. It was one of the oldest. You may be able to see on your handout, there was kind of a northern wing to the back that looked very similar to Dr. Baldwin's office. So that was the oldest portion of that house, about 1750. The front of the house, and the exterior and interior were apparently, allegedly brought over plans from Scotland, where Daniel Conrad was studying to be a doctor. The Conrad family had basically owned it, from the 1750s up until about 1953, I think, maybe a little earlier, maybe 1920s. And then the McCormicks operated it as apartment buildings for a while after that. It was sold to the city of Winchester, and it was pretty obvious it was going to be parking lot. That was the general progression of things. When the city was acquiring property, it was going to be a parking lot. So PHW, before we were PHW, also garden clubs, the Historical Society, individual citizens in Winchester all protested this, and there were really two parts of this. The first was in that 1963-1964 era when it was controlled by the city, and we managed to basically get that to a tie vote and prevent the funding for it. Right after that, the city turned it over to the Winchester Parking Authority. It had about five-year grace period or so before it was once again up for demolition. We were not able to stop the demolition. I wish I had the picture when it was parking lot straight across. But basically, this is your judicial center now. But at one point, it was parking straight across. And you could stand on the front steps of Rouse City Hall and see all the way over, basically, to the cemetery. You could see past the Star Building and up onto the hill. Even though we did lose this building, it was, I think, such a contentious and long and drawn out and public fight that it really cemented PHW and preservation as a fixture in Winchester. This is kind of the start of where we were trying to get the National Register nomination, the first one in the 1970s, the beginnings of the BAR, and also really the start of our revolving fund, as Pat mentioned. We started buying these kinds of endangered properties because we were told by City Council when we tried to save the Conrad House, if you don't buy them, you might as well face it, they're going to be lost. So we had to get hands in, save some buildings, and show that it could be done and it was worthwhile. I have a few others. Now, these are post-Conrad House, but I think they're worth mentioning just, you know, as kind of oddities, you know, kind of lost buildings. So this one is also on North Cameron Street, the Scott Affleck House. Scott Affleck was a farm implements dealer, and he had this building designed, or built basically from designs by George F. Barber, who was a mail-order architect. This was prior to Sears and Montgomery Wards and Aladdin Homes. He would not give you the kit. He would just give you the specifications, and you would have to build it locally. I am not sure that we knew when this house went down. This was basically right before BAR went into effect and demolitions would have to be approved. That, you know, that it was designed by an actual architect and it, you know, had this history to it. This is probably another one that was trying to slip in before regulations went into place. It was basically a drive-through that connected where the Masonic Lodge photo was on the mall, where that ATM is now. Kind of.
That's the Apple Blossom.
Apple Blossom headquarters, yep. And this one, this is obviously outside the district, but this was the Keckley Mill, and obviously as a mill, you're thinking, well, how old can it be? Most of the mills in Winchester were burned during the Civil War. This one actually survived because it was Quaker-owned. If you were a Quaker, you basically were able to say, I'm a Quaker, don't tear down my building, I'm not supporting slavery. And this building was pretty much intact. It supposedly had the water wheels, all of the original machinery in the building, but it was deemed unsafe. It had asbestos in it. So what do you do when it has asbestos? Just tear it down. This was demolished, about 1995. So it's very striking to me. As you look at the interior photos of this building, it is almost identical on the interior to the Kurtz building that we were working on about the same time. And I think the Kurtz building was probably in worse structural shape than this building. But, you know, it was a large building. It was outside of a historic district. There were no controls against demolition. This was the Hardee's. This was apparently Hardee's signature building style in the 1950s, 1960s, I guess. Ours in Winchester was built in 1967, I believe. And if it was in color, you'd be able to see it was a very vibrant orange and it stood out, obviously. Does anybody know the architectural style of this? It has a great name. Ray Gun Gothic.
What?
Ray Gun Gothic. So, yeah, it was basically inspired by the car culture and that kind of fascination with space and kind of futuristic stuff. So you'll see it referred to a lot of times as a tomorrow that never was. So by the 1970s, this was already out of fashion. Like, this was too over the top. It was too flashy. It was too campy. A lot of them have been, if they're still existing, they've been toned down, get rid of all that brightly colored panels and whoa. But in Winchester, we actually had some idea that this was actually an important building, and PHW did try to find a buyer to save that building, you know, basically dismantle it and take it somewhere else. It didn't happen, unfortunately. So we have a parking lot now, but that was interesting. That surprised me because that was definitely a one of a kind sort of building in Winchester, and that in the 1980s. We already had a sense in Winchester that that was something worth preserving. It was pretty amazing. So that is pretty much the main part of my slideshow. I have to plug the Stuart Bell Archives. A lot of the photos came from their collection. Also, we had some from E.E. Bayliss, Ben Ritter, and, of course, our collection. And if you enjoyed the slideshow, please consider donating your historic photos to the Stuart Bell Archives. It's a great resource for Winchester.